early 50s and early 60s, you were playing a different type of music, where Lil Anthony and Imperials, Impressions, you were into that kind of suits and conch tear and everything. What were the major influences that sort of pulled you from that to the present spiritual and political state that you're in now? What are the major influences that sort of pulled you out of that into the present state you're in now?
Man, our roots go Rastafari, you know, because when you check that road, everything was just searching, you know what I mean? Come and start search and we find His Majesty. We deal with it like we deal with it, yeah.
Okay, what's reggae and what is the woman's position in the Rastafarian movement? I mean, does she have input?
Woman is our mother. You know, we all come from mothers, you know. The woman, I mean, you know. You understand that?
Yeah, but I was thinking about more in terms of...
With Judy there. Yo, this is Judy out there. Call Judy for me and I'm actually explain this part, yeah, the woman part.
Okay, but until she comes, how about...
I understand what you said, but... I mean, you know, where that question come from, I don't understand where the question come from.
Sister Judy.
She's a Rasta sister.
Okay, I'd like to ask you about the woman's position in the movement. I mean, do you have a lot of input, or do you feel like you're more domestic? Is that your input?
Well, in the beginning, the woman has always been the domestic one. She's the one that takes care of the children and takes care of her husband. But we find that we have a particular talent and we have a work to do. So apart from taking care of children and taking care of the house, we have to fulfill that talent that God has given to us. Like us being on the road now, you know, as sisters, we leave our children behind and it's fulfilling our talent.
Okay, thank you.
On the same subject of women, there are a lot of, you know, brothers and sisters who have questions that we see you quite a bit. We see Tosh, we see Cliff. We're wondering, are there some female reggae artists that we will be able to see coming?
Well, there's one right here. You're looking at one. Another beautiful sister over there.
Yes, Sister Rita, she sings. She's an individual singer.
Solo artist. Mm-hmm.
Okay, in the present album that you've just released, Survival, there seems to be a lot of personal things that have happened in that and some tragedies that have happened. What sort of inspired you to write the lyrics in the present album?
Pressure of the time, you know? The pressure of the time. That cast lyrics. It's survival time, you know? And, you know, the situation of our going. None of that.
Read it in Revelations. Mm. You'll find your redemption. Mm. Give us the teachings of His Majesty.
It's true. Yeah,
okay, I'd like you to tell us a little bit about your paper, Survival.
Oh, you mean the survival paper? Uh-huh. Let me tell. Well, this paper, you know. Some people have an idea one time they want to make a fan club. Mm-hmm. But you don't really like the fan club business, you know? And them started, so we say better make a paper. Uh-huh. So what we really try to know is that most time everyone write about Rasta, you know? And Rasta don't really write about themselves. So we try to know, we try to write our own paper. Mm-hmm. So, if you want to hear what both people are saying, you can hear what they want to say, you can hear what the Rasta man is saying. You know?
Uh-huh.
Says it was starting now.
Okay. In the Rasta movement that Haile Selassie is no longer with us in the physical form, what at the present day is the movement and the energy and the force that keeps the Rasta movement, keep going at this point?
The question is, the whole answer to the question is that Noah have three sons, Shem and Japhet, you know. And I am from Africa. His Majesty, our Father. When you search and find out who missing is Jesus Christ. It's kind of modern day Bible. See him revealed as Jesus. So that's what we deal with. Him are the God Almighty now. So when His Majesty deal with I and I know, you know, him not deal with I and I different, like say for instance now. What is happening today? You know, and what is happening today? Who make the laws of what is happening today? I know that some of them die from 18th century. But the people them still run off of the same 18th century guy. You hear me say? No, you know, His Majesty different. His Majesty a God Almighty. But I'm sure you say no, this image worship, where you want to worship the image, you have to deal with the consciousness of where the whole consciousness of the people is. So when I want him to come forward, and I mean every man, we know him. So the movement gets stronger. Because the consciousness coming. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? Some people think God is going to be a big great cloud. They just look up and see the big great cloud, you know. But it's inside. And you can check it out on the earth too, you know. Some people say His Majesty, blah, blah, boom, boom, gone. But when we ask them now, the ideology or the philosophy where you rule by now, how long that guy died? Some of them died from the 17th century. So Rasta is new, it's Christ time, you know. So it's just another way of that consciousness where we really deal with.
Would you say that Marcus Garvey has a lot of political influence within the movement?
Marcus Garvey is a prophet, man. Marcus Garvey tells that we must look to the east for the king, when the king comes. 1930s, Majesty, come on, pan, you know, and I see him from them time there. Till it could have come, that's I could have come know him at this time. Marcus Garvey, you know, up till now, Marcus Garvey prophecy go on forever. You know, there's a lot of things Marcus Garvey say, and a lot of it come to pass. And some still live, and everyone see it. I mean, get more stronger, you know, in reality. As everything we say them time happened today, and everyone see it happening. Well played.
Okay, this is kind of personal. I'd like to know about the assassination attempt on you. I haven't heard anything about what the government is doing with it, and I hear that your song Ambush is like directly related to that experience. And I'd like to know what is the government? I haven't heard anything else. No one's been apprehended.
Yeah, we don't want nobody to do nothing about nothing, you know. No, we don't want the government to do anything about anything or anything like that. Ambush is, you know, Ambush make us stronger, you know. Because everyone knows to His Majesty where I live. So, you know what I mean? I can't really deal with it on a different level. We deal with it like how God deal with it. It's true in where we live. So today I'm going to tell you, His Majesty is God. We can prove it. You know what I mean? We have more than proof.
If we're relating to the music, where specifically did the reggae beat itself come from?
Good. Why? Going
there. Yeah, the reggae beat originally come from the Africans. We same way with African music, and we're Africans scattered abroad. So it come as a kind of rebellion against just playing music for just gaiety or for just merriness and just, you know, without no consciousness. Come up as a consciousness. It close, when you say reggae, it's like you say Rasta. So it's the music liberate your mind. And it's only music right now where actually I speak directly to the people instead of carrying them around in fantasy or showing them something else, you know? Fantasy is the thing right now, you know? The more you can go into fantasy, the bigger you'll be in the fantasy world. But Rasta music deal with ground nation, reality, the things that you must confront. So it's just, that's what it's all about.
I've heard reggae music described by an African artist as African rhythms with Jamaican feeling. Does that seem to...
Yeah, that's almost like what I just said.
Okay, about music. I was in Ghana this summer, and everyone loves the Wailers. They just love them. But it's really hard to get music, your albums there, because it's so expensive. And I was talking to Neville earlier, and he's telling me that you're establishing a base in West Africa. Are you touring there also?
Yeah, I try. We don't really do it yet, but, you know, I try to do it.
Okay. We really be looking forward to it.
When you're composing your songs, where do your greatest revelations and stimulations come from? Do you know, a lot of people might say, do you get it riding on the bus? Do you get it when you're at late at night? Or when you have herb and you're feeling good? I mean, revelations come wide through God. How do they come to you?
Just come here. I can't time it. It comes any time. It don't come 10, 12, or 11.
Right.
It comes
any time. Many ideas come to you while you're out there, you know, but it seems that through the inspiration is majesty. Him really wants certain message at the time to go to the people. So I'm kind of inspired and I have to bring out the right message. So we have to give thanks for that. Because like, if you listen to Survivor right now, I feel it's very relevant, you know, to the time. And that's what we have to try and keep doing, you know, keep it relevant. Because it's easy to go in the studio and just make up, you know, something to sell, you know. But everyone's confused with that right now, so we have to try and find an alternative to that. Yeah.
Some people say that revolutionary music can only come from within a revolutionary movement. And so you have a song like Zimbabwe, which you guys are, you know, made over here, but it's about an African country. What do you say to that? People tell you that, you know, you're not in physically in that liberation movement, therefore, you know, you can't write music about it.
No, we say, soon you'll find out who is the real revolutionary.
Who can say that?
Who,
you know, can say that?
Some people who read, you know.
What are they doing towards revolution?
Some people in the studies department, they bring this to my attention. They say, well, ask him, you know, what does he think of that?
Are they doing anything towards revolution?
Excuse me?
Are they doing anything?
They're over here.
Towards revolution, I'm asking now.
And I fight revolution, man. And I had a revolutionaries. We don't even have to tell people that. You know, we don't want to tell no one that. You know what I mean? So we talk about African struggle. You see, you know Jamaica? You know how Jamaica and how black people reach Jamaica? You know how? The history of that? The history of it is through slavery. So when you're in Jamaica and you talk about Africa, when you're in the West and you speak of Africa, like maybe 7 years ago, mm-hmm. It was terrible. You know that? You know what I mean? You could even talk to your own black man about Africa and tell you you're not dealing with Africa.
Yeah.
Then I fight for Africa, man. You know, His Majesty. If it wasn't for Haile Selassie, there wouldn't be no Africa.
True.
It would have been Europe. I'm not changing names so much, you wouldn't have no Ethiopia. See? So when I talk about
revolution,
man. And I want to tell you, if the revolution must, if they want to win the revolution, they must win it with Rasta. Mm-hmm. It can't win no other way. Because if you win other way, you have to fight again. When Rasta win, there's no more war.
Sure.
Right, the end of all wars.
Cause of war, forget about that. The root of the problem. That's what that
if time. You study the lyrics to the song War, you see what His Majesty had to say about it.
Yeah.
And if you can base your life on that philosophy, then you become a Rasta, you know? can help you.
Go ahead. I feel you become a Rasta automatically when you discover yourself, when you find what you're living for and what man's purpose is on this earth, you know, and start living in that direction, then you become a Rasta.
Today and in the past, the media has always presented leaders to us and have told us this is our leader. Do you see any blacks in the world today who you could truly say are real leaders for black people?
The leader has come already, man. And the leader won't be a man in our sense, like a man who come and say he's a leader. Truth, Haile Selassie is a leader. You want the iron to know, to develop yourself towards that direction. But I am a leader already. I want him a leader. A little argument. You know the history of Ethiopia? Mm-hmm. You know it from the beginning. Mm-hmm. It says this is the whole thing there. You know? So it's that have happened. We have to keep it. So as Majesty say, that's what we have to agree with. Because any man come with any leadership business, he must have, I think, him opposition. Yes. So we are dealing with the truth, through roots, through revelation, or reveal the truth. So you don't have no leader. And you just deal with the truth.
Right now.
We have people who make moves, yes. You know what I mean?
Joshua
get things
Kuma
together.
Because Joshua Nkrumah, he's putting up a heavy fight right now. He's one of the only people right now who's putting up a fight.
Who is
that? Joshua Nkrumah. Like in England right now. Yeah, you know, because that's one of the main problems with black people's life, you know. Destiny. South Africa, Rhodesia, Zimbabwe, anywhere around there. As soon as that is straightened up and everyone knows where that is, then we know we're moving somewhere. But until that is come and go, talk and talk, nothing will really happen. You know, no leader can do anything. You know what I mean? Because that's really a stumbling block right now.
I know a lot of Africans that come from different parts of the world, whether born on the continent or not, come to America and they look at so-called black Americans, and a lot of us seem to be hung up into materialism, Hollywood, and things like this. How do you view the black American in terms of making contributions to the revolution?
Marcus Garvey come to America and get up over 6 million black people already. So as the black people in America, as one of His Majesty Army, where him say him have no the West. Yeah? So, you know, you might find a one and two kind of, but you have a lot of them are solid. Wait for the right time.
Africa waited clear.
You come for the Africans here, not the black Americans.
Africans are told me
it's Africans. This is, we'll cut off the America part.
So this would be primarily the Pan-Africanist view,
yes,
that we are all Africans.
Yes.
Yeah, but at the same time, you can't tell some, as far as I see it, at the same time, you cannot tell some black people who call themselves, like you said, black Americans, that, you know, because they're here working for their money, and their big house, and their car, and their insurance, and their debt benefit. I'm telling you, I'm going to live here and be fat and work and retire and die.
And have cancer. And
you know, so you cannot even deal with them people. Eh? You know, if you deal with Africans, you know, a leopard cannot change his spot now that you eat up on the skin. You know, so we're looking for people who know it with the mark of the Almighty upon them heart.
Yeah, I'm sure there are a lot of revolutionary-minded black Americans, but they are powerless without the mass of black Americans being conscious, you know? The only way they can do anything mentally, spiritually, or physically is if they have the people behind them.
Unity is strength.
You know?
One thing you have to remember that as black people, our gift is wisdom and knowledge, and that's been hidden from black people for a long time. So we now have to be aware of that fact and start to use it because it's our natural talent. So that's part of, you know, the whole thing, is to know what your talent is and search for your roots, you know. Because the deeper you go, the further out you can branch.
Yeah, unity is the highest power, mm-hmm. definitely. We strive towards unity.
Yeah, and we don't necessarily want war, you know what I mean? But if the only way you can get your freedom is to fight for it, then you have to fight. If you corner a rat, he's gonna stay there scared for a while, but after a while he's gonna jump you, you know? And look how small he is. So, people.
Yeah, man. You must remember at the same time also that when we talk about war, you know, we're not talking about just gun and bayonet and bombs and missile and all them things, you know. Talking about earthquake, lightning and thunder.
Spiritual.
You know, got all them business, yeah, them click, click, and them things that cannot work in the war, you know. The war, even the spiritual war, you know. So when you ever talk about war, don't think so we carry a gun and knife on us. We're dealing with a higher divinity.
Vibration.
Rastaman vibration, which is lightning, earthquake, because the earth, they come back for what it wants, you know, for itself, you know.
Because man is trying to be as powerful as God.
Pan-African struggle, because they're very, everyone is very, I see a lot of influence from the West there. I mean, people are worried about acquiring wealth so they can get their Mercedes, and those people are not, they're running the countries, and they're not concerned about pulling the movement and bringing up the masses.
Well, the first thing you have to do is get rid of the pan. This Pan-African thing is a mix-up thing, you know, the African thing we're dealing with now. Yeah. Well, you're gonna, you see, God said, I shall gather my children from afar and from the ends of the earth. See my David? So you see, just like how Israel crossed the Red Sea and come all in places, so, we have to cross it again. History must repeat itself, you know, because God lives. See? So forget about this pan business. The Pan-African. No Pan-African. Africa never named Pan-African, you know, name Africa. Ethiopia.
What do you feel about Ethiopia now after Haile Selassie?
Haile Selassie is.
Oh, but though, after he left Ethiopia.
Ethiopia, man. God didn't leave his kingdom, man.
So you don't, what's your affinity for the rulers there now?
Rulers, young love one ruler, you know, like the man said a while ago, young love one almighty ruler, Rastafari, you see it? Your divinity. There's one almighty ruler. You see, what he, you know, you mustn't watch pen, you know, because my tongue, is a pen after the ready writer, you know. Don't watch a black and white thing, you know, that thing on the paper there. It's coming from a spiritual conception, the heart. You know, so God is, God will be forever and ever.
And Haile Selassie
is God. God, Rastafari.
Guy can't change that.
You know, any apology, you know, who don't like it, just drop
no guy
dead.
Guy can't change that. No, Rastafari.
You
know,
Ethiopia fall in a position. Ethiopia is in a position now, like when Christ was on the cross. Like, Christ was crucified between two criminals, right? Mm-hmm. One on the left and one on his right. Mm-hmm. Now, if you check it, the roots man is being crucified, one on his left and one on his right. He don't know if he must go left, he don't know if he must go right. And there's nowhere right in front.
Had to go straight,
you know?
Ahead.
So that's what happening to Ethiopia now, and plenty third world country. Tug of war between left and right.
Left,
right, left, right, left, right.
When there's a problem for
right.
Food,
and left, right, and right.
Nobody don't want to help, right? When there's a problem for food.
Right.
But when it comes to war now, everybody wants to help.
Ready to sell their arms immediately.
Right now you have half the world starving, you know?
No one helped Ethiopia during the famine there in 73, 74 with the drought. But everyone helped when the war started with Somalia. This is how world affairs run. You don't help starving people, but you can sell guns and ammunition, and spear parts.
And that I think, too, continuing to what the brethren say. You see, them people around this area will go to this school and study this university business. But most of them come out of them more confused, you know, than anything else, you know, because it's like, yeah. But which life? Oh, never Rasta.
Never went to this school.
But he did go to this
never is Rasta, never born Rasta,
no,
man.
He said some of them.
Come on, David, no, listen to me, you know. You have some brother and sister, Rona, so some guys, really, who go to school and them tell you about, oh, I've been studying this and I'm that. And no school upon this earth teach about life. None. Them come out more confused, them head cross turn and them hide them blind to the whole thing. And them will never know God. Because this thing is a prison, you know, this place, you know. It's a prison, prison within a prison. So you must see up.
Feels like this sometimes. But I have a question directed to Neville. All right, you came here, were you a Rasta when you were at UCLA? Or did you, I mean, how did you come to be in this movement?
In the movement, true reality. Like, as a black man, always viewing black in a cultural way, searching for the true way. Like, when I was here, I was in the Black Panther Party. Uh-huh. I was marching up and down with Angela Davis. I was here during a time when black Americans was really dealing with something. Their voices were being heard. Like, it kind of changed now. So at that time, like, you had to be militant to survive. Never hear much talk about human rights. It was a struggle. Well, the struggle is still on. There's no real change being made. So coming here, right, I find Rasta fully when I really leave here and return home after checking out Babylon and really seeing what the university and the world have to offer. Well, I return home and I come here and check, well then, God is the best answer than materialism, so I choose God way. But it's an inborn concept. Rasta, you find Rasta through searching for the truth.
One truth.
And it's just one truth you can find. That answer your question.
Last time I was able to talk to you was about 2-3 years ago, and we were talking about record companies, and you were saying, I'm playing the music, but these white guys seem to be getting all the money. Has there been any moves in terms of blacks controlling the reggae industry?
Well, I've asked, you know, if there's any move, you see any blacks making any record company out here.
We are the
Bronx. BMA convention in
Philadelphia.
And we saw progress for black music because black people were able to come together from all parts of the world and exchange ideas and talk about how we can, you know, unify even stronger. So there is improvement. At the concerts, the audiences have changed. We have more blacks coming to our concerts now, which is what we would like to see. And although we're not into a color thing, we're into, you know, a oneness. We still have to develop our own people. And the BMA thing proved that there is some progress being made.
What direction do you see black music going in the next 2-5 years?
Well, if disco dies, anything is possible.
Well, after the natural death.
Well, there isn't much change really for black music, because black music is on the one. Rhythm. Can't change. The tempo, the only thing that might change is the arrangements, but the tempo will still be the same. What I would like to see is like something more hip being said, you know, because it's such a vehicle.
Yeah.
Music is such a heavy vehicle. You have millions of people open listening. You know, if you could teach them something, no matter who it is, you know, Rod Stewart, anybody.
Right, if they now, could just, you know, there's too much sex involved in music right now. It's not really teaching you anything other than pornography.
Yeah, well,
and you know,
the earth is occupied territory. You know, the earth is the devil's territory. So. You know, say in occupied territory, you know, the majority, who is the majority, so whoever have any godliness about them now have to start showing it up in this next decade, because right, I don't want to sound like a madman, but God is coming.
God is here.
Well, yeah. No, but God is coming to judge.
True.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, who can feel it? Don't have no feeling. Death. Because, you know.
Is this why your music, like you saying when you were into the Temptation look, you know, the conquer and everything, now it's more?
We never have any conquer in our, just we don't conquer
in Jamaica. No, just man used to
those suits.
Hey, sister, here it is. Sister Law.
But now your music is much more political. And is this why? Because there's a message that needs to be said?
Naturally.
Relevant. Music is getting more relevant.
Music is like international language. You're ready to go. And you have to make music from the audience.
You write really nice songs about love ballads, the ballads you do. So it's just, is it just a life experience that you're trying to relate?
Yeah, because you have to love too.
I mean, not made out of wood.
Okay.
time is about running out. Anybody in the audience would like to ask a question?
Yes, anybody
want to
ask a question?
In terms of understanding that the reality of our people's present condition in terms of, on a worldwide condition, in terms of their level of consciousness, being that it has been stifled by the lack of information through all forms of media, whether it be books from kindergarten to the university level, whether all forms of music, you know, that come across the waves. And even now, right now, the true, genuine, what is happening in the world in terms of our conditioning is not played on the radio as much as it should be. So in terms of establishing a viable, you know, worldwide communication networks that's viable to the raising of the African nation and our people, I think that these are some of the steps that all of us should be making, conscious steps toward. And I definitely recognize the reality of survival as taking, in terms of the new newspaper, taking steps in that direction. I want to, if not in full detail, but ask you in terms of what do you see as can be done in your group's opinion as to enhance this, to bring it about more rapidly.
Interest from people outside, you know, got make not Jamaica. So you have people out there who are interested, forget it.
It's because so much has been said to the people, you know, over the years, like for the past 5-6 years, so much has been said in that direction, you know. It's really up to the people, you know, to come, you know what I mean?
This is being filmed. There'll be children 10 years from now looking at this and wondering who you are. Can we have all your names?
If children looking 10 years from this?
Yes.
And this?
Right.
Children won't be wondering who is in the because children 10 years from this is Rasta.
But I just wanted to know your names and what you play.
Congos, Devon.
Ba. Tyrone, keyboards.
Junior, guitar.
Wire, keyboards.
Neville, color the music.
Carlton,
drums.
We have over there Mr. Family Man Barrett.
This.
All right. I just stepped in. Where's
that? We have one more question.
The ladies, where's Judy and Rita? Yeah, would you like to ask the ladies any questions?
One question, we have a question from this person.
Yeah, I'd like to ask Bob the relation between the Ethiopian Orthodox Church in Florida and that in Jamaica. And there is another Orthodox Church in Los Angeles. What kind of relation it has with the whole Rasta movement?
Well, Ethiopian Orthodox Church. There's an Ethiopian Orthodox Church in Miami.
Yeah.
There's one in Florida.
Zion Coptic.
Ethiopian. There is an Ethiopian Orthodox Church.
Well, all Ethiopian, dig this, all Ethiopian Orthodox, we deal with this from Ethiopia, it's Rasta. See, if it's a different thing, like Zion Coptic, we're not really a deal with nothing. It's not Rasta that.
We love the Ethiopian.
All the Ethiopian. Yeah, they identify with Rasta.
That is set up by His Majesty.
That is the Abraham House. That is the house where you ever hear about the house of the man Bill. Every day them sing a song. The house that Jack built.
This is the house that Jack built.
The Ark of the Covenant. It's supposed to be possessed by the Ethiopian Orthodox Church. The Ark of the Covenant. and the Ten Commandments.
Yeah, man.
How about one
the tablets.
More question?
His Majesty the Christ, and the God in the return, you know. So you hear me now, I'm telling you something now. Look upon the earth today, you have three things in front of you. You have America, you have Russia, and you have Rasta. It's easy as that. That's what you have, really.
So it's in all people's movies.
That's what you have. You can check it from long time. You find when Pope Paul sent Mussolini to attack Ethiopia, you will find out how today, how the famine come, why no one ever try help the black people, because that His Majesty, they make them all help, you know. You realize when His Majesty in Ethiopia, if Russia would feed the Ethiopian them, America would help feed them, I wouldn't His Majesty them a feed them, would be the people. So when I'm trying, you know, I'm trying to show up His Majesty in some propaganda style and show the people a different side of the propaganda, so everyone say, yeah, 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 which is not true. Because today you only have three. Russia, America, and Ethiopia, which is Rasta. Black people have something. This is where you're going to be. You're going to be a Marx and a Lenin. I tell you that is German or Russia. You're going to be a capitalist. I'm going to tell you that is American, European, whiteness. If he's an African, then you must be a Rasta, the new name. Christ him shall return a new name. Same new name as Rasta, not that, just as we say, in new name is. But if you check it out for yourself, you'll find out that as easy as
one
that, it's really
more,
that way.
Are there any black Catholics in America?
Black Catholics?
How much? A lot?
Many.
Woodside is a black
Muslim. Many.
Woodside is a black Muslim.
Woodside?
Woodside here. A black Muslim. Who follow the black Muslim faith inside here? Because there is no such thing as black Muslim, you know.
I'll show you one more thing again. Look upon it easy. His Majesty now, if America did help Ethiopia, His Majesty would have to be a capitalist. If Russia did help Ethiopia, His Majesty would have to be a communist.
Yeah.
So, him want to be himself. So them claim them overthrow him. Well, them no overthrow him. For I and I are ourselves, and we not change.
Yeah,
can't change them. I think there's some, you know.
Yeah, how do you feel to have a child born into this world and the first thing you have to teach them? Well, if you want to survive, you have to be subject to this guy or you have to be subject to that guy, you know? It's not inspiring, you know? You have to change all of that.
Yeah.
Yes.
Thank you, Wailers.